The Emperor's New Clothes by Hans Christian Andersen. Many years ago there was an emperor who was so exceedingly fond of new clothes that he spent all his money in dress. He did not trouble himself in the least about his soldiers, nor did he care to go either to the theater or to the chase, except for the opportunities they afforded him for displaying his new clothes. He had a different suit for each hour of the day, and as of any other king or emperor, one is accustomed to say, "He is sitting in council." It was always said of him, "The emperor is sitting in his wardrobe." Time passed merrily in the large town which was his capital. Strangers arrived every day at the court. One day, two rogues, calling themselves weavers, made their appearance. They gave out that they knew how to weave stuffs of the most beautiful colors and elaborate patterns, the clothes manufactured from which should have the wonderful property of remaining invisible to everyone who was unfit for the office he held, or who was extraordinarily simple in character. "These must indeed be splendid clothes," thought the emperor. "Had I such a suit, I might at once find out what men in my realms are unfit for their office, and also be able to distinguish the wise from the foolish. This stuff must be woven for me immediately." And he caused large sums of money to be given to both the weavers in order that they might begin their work directly. So the two pretended weavers set up two looms and affected to work very busily, though in reality they did nothing at all. They asked for the most delicate silk and the purest gold thread, put both into their own knapsacks, and then continued their pretended work at the empty loom until late in the night. "I should like to know how the weavers are getting on with my cloth," said the emperor to himself. After some little time had elapsed, he was, however, rather embarrassed, when he remembered that a simpleton, or one unfit for his office, would be unable to see the manufacture. To be sure, he thought he had nothing to risk in his own person, but yet he would prefer to send somebody else to bring the intelligence about the weavers and their work before he troubled himself in the affair. All the people throughout the city had heard of the wonderful property that the cloth was to possess, and all were anxious to learn how wise, or how ignorant, their neighbors might prove to be. "I will send my faithful old ministers to the weavers," said the emperor at last, after some deliberation. "He will be best able to see how the cloth looks, for he is a man of sense, and no one can be more suitable for his office than he is." So the faithful old minister went into the hall, where the knaves were working with all their might at their empty looms. "What can be the meaning of this?" thought the old man, opening his eyes very wide. "I cannot discover the least bit of thread on the looms." However, he did not express his thoughts aloud. The impostors requested him very courteously to be so good as to come nearer their looms, and then asked him whether the design pleased him, and whether the colors were not very beautiful, at the same time pointing to the empty frames. The poor old minister looked and looked. He could not discover anything on the looms, for a very good reason, viz., there was nothing there. "What?" thought he again. "Is it possible that I am a simpleton? I have never thought so myself, and no one must know it now if I am so. Can it be that I am unfit for my office? No, that must not be said either. I will never confess that I could not see the stuff." "Well, sir minister," said one of the knaves, still pretending to work, "you do not say whether the stuff pleases you."
"Oh, it is excellent," replied the old minister, looking at the loom through his spectacles. "This pattern and the colors, yes. I will tell the emperor without delay, How very beautiful I think them. We shall be much obliged to you, said the impostors. And then they named the different colors and described the patterns of the pretended stuff. The old minister listened attentively to their words, in order that he might repeat them to the emperor. And then the knaves asked for more silk and gold, saying that it was necessary to complete what they had begun. However, they put all that was given them into their knapsacks, and continued to work with as much apparent diligence as before at their empty looms. The emperor now sent another officer of his court to see how the men were getting on, and to ascertain whether the cloth would soon be ready. It was just the same with this gentleman as with the minister. He surveyed the looms on all sides, but could see nothing at all but the empty frames. "Does not the stuff appear as beautiful to you as it did to my lord the minister?" asked the impostors of the emperor's second ambassador, at the same time making the same gestures as before, and talking of the design and colors which were not there.
"I'm certainly not stupid," thought the messenger. "It must be that I am not fit for my good profitable office. That is very odd, however. No one shall know anything about it."
And accordingly he praised the stuff he could not see, and declared that he was delighted with both colors and patterns.